Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praise due to Allah alone. We praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May there be some blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to a new edition of your program Ask Huda. Phone numbers are as usual, area code 002-0238-555-248 or 249, and the email address is ask@huda.tv. A couple of pending questions. The first one from Arshad, a young viewer, which is an extremely important question. So do not blame me if I spend some quality time explaining the answer of this question. Arshad said, is it true that different religions have different attributes? Some say, as he watched in some programs, TV programs, some say that the Jews are very smart. Is it true? First of all, with regards to the different attributes of religion or religions, we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not state nor approve but only one religion. And all the prophets whom he has sent to mankind have been preaching the same religion. Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, by the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah said, trying to disown himself from the sin of his people, ما قلت لهم إلا ما أمرتني به أن اعبدوا الله ربي وربكم وكنت عليهم شهيدا ما دمت فيهم. He will say, I did not tell them other than what you informed me to tell them. أن اعبدوا الله ربي وربكم. Worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord. Then when you examine Surah Al-A'raf, there are several verses in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by saying, for innocence, وإلى عاد أخاهم هودا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ وَإِلَى ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ. And so on. Every prophet had been sent with the same message, which is اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ. Worship Allah alone. مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ. You have no other God other than Allah the Almighty. Don't you fear Him? Don't you worship Him? Don't you have sense? Don't you understand? And so on. The message of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the seal of the prophethood, was also the same. So there is only one religion with various prophets. The belief is monotheism. The aqidah is the same. The akhlaq which these shara'i' inspire its peoples and followers with are the same. But the legislations may differ from haram to halal depending on the needs and what fits people most. The message of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is different than any other message, in a sense that, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ يُبْعَثُ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ خَاصَّةً وَبُعِثْتُ إِلَىٰ النَّاسِ كَافَّةً. Every messenger before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been sent exclusively for his people. Jesus, Moses, Aaron are all for the children of Israel. Every prophet was sent to his people. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's message is the only universal message. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ كَافَّةً. I'm the messenger of Allah and to all of you. And وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Surah Al-Anbiya, we have not sent you but as a mercy for everything that exists, not only humans and the jinn, but even animals and every living creature. As far as what the media portrays sometimes, and you gotta understand that the media, especially the Western media, is mainly owned by the Jewish lobby. So I do not blame them if they portray the Jewish personality as smart, intelligent, and invisible, and superior to others, and have the leadership in science, in math, etc. But that is not true. People are smart based on gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them, based on education, based on investing and utilizing this intelligence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. We have the best doctors, the best scientists in America and Europe are Muslims. So it have nothing to do with being a Jew or a Muslim or a Christian. If you invest in this talent which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you, then you are smart. But what the kids watch in Hollywood movies, which as I said, owned, produced and funded by Jews, portraying the Jewish personality as the smartest and the most intelligent. As a matter of fact, they do that even with adults. They do that even with other countries. Remember when they occupied a great portion of Sinai in Egypt, and they built Bar-Lev line, and they said that no force on earth can invade it nor cross it. And it was only a matter of a few hours where the Egyptian soldiers were able to go into the heart of Israel. They were afraid that they're going to occupy Tel Aviv. So what I'm saying here is, look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the children of Israel. There are a couple of verses in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah which gives us a sense of why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make certain people superior to others, and whether it is for granted or based on conditions. You fulfill the condition, then you're superior. You do not, then you're inferior. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in two verses in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 47 and verse number 122, he said, Ya Bani Israel, O children of Israel, اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم. Remember my favor which I bestowed upon you. وأني فضلتكم على العالمين. And I also made you superior to العالمين, the people of their time. That's in two verses. Was this superiority infinite and for granted? No. Because when you go to another verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 78, we find the Quran says, لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُودَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ ذَلِكَ بِمَا عَصَوا وَكَانُوا يَعْتَدُونَ كَانُوا لَا يَتَنَاهَوْنَ عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ فَعَلُوهُ لَبِئْسَ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. Some of the children of Israel, those who disbelieved, have been cursed and accursed by Allah and by their own prophets. عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُودَ, Prophet David, وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ, and Jesus the son of Mary. Why? As a result of their rebelliousness. Because they did not fulfill what Allah commanded, as the next verse explains. Prophet Moses, peace be upon himself, when they crossed the sea, their main mission was to enter Jerusalem and to flee it from the infidels. They refused. And they said, you know what? You go and your Lord fight. We'll hang around here. And when you free the city, we will enter it. They said, اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إن هاهنا قاعدون. Musa alayhi salam had to apologize to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, Ya Rabbi, إِنِّي لَا أَمْلِكُ إِلَّا نَفْسِي وَأَخِي فَافْرُقْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. I have no followers. Guess what? That was said after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed them signs after signs. And the greatest of all, when they crossed the sea, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a dry road in the middle, and they crossed the sea and they saw the Pharaoh and his soldiers being drowned before their very eyes, but still, they turned Musa down. They said, you go and your Lord fight. So he said, I have no followers. It's just me and my brother Harun. فَفْرُقْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. So make segregation between us, me and my brother, and the rebellious people. This is how he described his own people. وَجَاوَزْنَا بِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ الْبَحْرَ فَأَتَوْا عَلَى قَوْمٍ يَعْكُفُونَ عَلَى أَصْنَامٍ لَهُمْ قَالُوا يَا مُوسَى اجْعَلْ لَنَا إِلَهًا كَمَا لَهُمْ آلِهَةٌ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. Right after they were saved and they crossed the sea, they went to the shore, they noticed that some people were worshipping idols. Cows were made into idols, and people were worshipping them. So they turned to Musa a.s. and said, Oh Moses, why don't you make some idols for us, gods like them? We want to have a tangible God. We want to have a materialistic God that whom we can touch and beg and pray for. قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. So this is the fact of the children of Israel from the mouth of their own prophets, whether Moses or Jesus, peace be upon him, and so on. Those who think that a particular person is genius and it's in the gene, it's in an entire nation, or invisible as you watch in the Hollywood movies and the particularly the American heroes, that is not true. Smartness and intelligence is a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants certain people. It's a gift. In addition to the person, if he invests properly, he benefits himself and his family and, of course, entire humanity. If he believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be rewarded for that as well. but it's not in a certain country or certain gene or certain hormone. Okay. The first caller today, Assalamu alaikum. Ummu Adam from the KSA, Assalamu alaikum.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum, Ummu Adam.
Alaikum salam. I have a question I would like to ask. What do you think can we as a Muslims do today to unify the Ummah again so that in the future, inshallah, we can be one Ummah again? What is your recommendation? Thank you very much.
You're most welcome, Ummu Adam, and thank you for your keenness to unite the Ummah. Jazakumullah khairan. Fawaz from KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah. Sheikh, my question is, we work in engineering and we do some estimation to a project. And this project is a building, and inside the building there is a waiting room for people to come. And they put a TV there that shows some news channels and stuff with, you know, English news channels and stuff like that. So is it allowed for us like to do this kind of thing, or is this like helping people to watch simple things, and we get it's not allowed for us to participate in such a project?
Okay, Fawaz, it depends on the contents. There are some news channels which only air news without any violation, without any committing any restrictions in the deen. And you know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
And since you're calling from the KSA, there is Al-Majd, for instance, news channel, which I enjoy watching, and I feel very comfortable that I would not be exposed to anything that is... There are certain news channels in Arabic, funded by some Muslim countries, which I make certain not to watch because of what you see on the channel. The hosts are very awful in displaying their beauties and their makeup and so on. If I air that, I will be definitely responsible for those who watch it as well. فَالدَّلُّ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ لَهُ أَجْرُ فَاعِلِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Do not help one another nor assist one another to achieve transgression and commit sins. Okay? Abu Radwan from India has a very important question as well. He had three questions we got to answer to last time. His third question is, there are some countries that claim to be Muslims, so many people make hijrah to them. Is this hijrah? And he's calling from India. Al-Hijrah, which means migration, could be mandatory if a person lives in a non-Muslim country where he or she is oppressed, cannot practice their religious duties, cannot declare their faith, and they have a chance to migrate to a Muslim land. The issue of a Muslim state or a Muslim country or Muslim land is relative. I don't want anyone to imagine that there is a Muslim country nowadays similar to that which was at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you travel to this country, you will find Al-Ansar waiting for you, cheering and receiving you and sharing their wealth with you. I don't think this is happening nowadays, but it's a relative matter. So to move to a Muslim country where at least I get to hear the Adhan, learn the Quran, hang around good people, is of course better than living amongst people who disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oppose Islam and Muslims. They chase me for because my wife is wearing hijab, or chase the ladies because they're wearing hijab, and they discriminate me. And sometimes I don't get to offer my prayers because I'm being oppressed. In this condition, the hijrah is a must. But if a person is living even in a non-Muslim country, his mission is to give da'wah to his family, to relatives, colleagues, and so on, and he is free to practice his religious duties, he's not being oppressed, then the hijrah in this case is voluntary, is recommended. It's not a must. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah An-Nisa, verse number 97, regarding those who are living in non-Muslim lands, where they are not free to practice their deen, they are being oppressed, they have to conceal their iman. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا فَأُولَئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. At the time of death, for those who died in non-Muslim countries, And the condition is they are not practicing their deen because they are afraid or being oppressed or discriminated against. The angels would ask them, فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ? What's the matter with you? Why weren't you practicing? They say, قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. We have been oppressed on earth. We could not do our deen or practice our religious duties because we have been oppressed. So they answer them, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. Allah's land is very spacious. Why didn't you do hijrah or make hijrah? In order to be able to practice your deen freely, as long as you have access. But if one is experiencing such conditions and does not have fun, nor have access, nor does he know what to do, in this condition Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is exempting them from the punishment by saying, إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ من الرجال والنساء والولدان لا يستطيعون حينة ولا يهتدون سبيلا فأولئك عسى الله أن يعفو عنهم وكان الله عفوا غفورا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لا هجرة بعد الفتح ولكن جهاد ونية. There is no migration after the conquest of Mecca, but there is jihad for the sake of Allah, and there is sincere in your intention before doing anything. Some people misunderstood this hadith and said there is no more hijrah. That's not true. The hijrah which is ended at the time is the migration from Mecca to Medina. Because Mecca, after it was the home of disbelief, now it has become the center of belief on earth. So there is no sense to migrate from Mecca anymore to Al-Medina or anywhere else. But Al-Hijrah will last until the Day of Judgment. Any person who is living in such conditions where he or she are unable to practice the religious duties and declare their faith are required to migrate to the Muslim land, even if it is not the best Islamic state which we long for. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Muhammad from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you?
Alhamdulillah. I just want to ask if it is possible to perform Umrah with a group of women without mahram.
Where are you now? Where are you located?
In Gurayat.
You have to travel a travel distance, you mean?
Yes.
Okay. The answer is, it is not permissible for a woman, for a Muslim woman who believes in Allah and in the last day, to travel a travel distance without a male mahram. That is the hadith which is presented by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam repeatedly. Accordingly, the vast majority of the jurists base their view on this and similar hadith, that unless if it is necessary, a woman has to travel for a treatment, for moving, for whatever, and does not have a male mahram nor a company, that's a different issue. But traveling voluntarily without a male mahram for a Muslim woman is not allowed, as long as it is the travel distance. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Arshad again from Qatar. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. I'm very thankful you answered my question, and it cleared up a lot of stuff in my life. You know, like I'm going to, like I'm in now 8th and also cleared up a lot of stuff.
Do you watch a lot of Superman, Arshad?
Hello?
Do you watch a lot of Superman?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
I don't know. Last time I had asked about the Jews, and the answer you answered was really good. But I wanted to ask, like, the Jews are smart in business. That's what I heard on Qatar TV, on a program called Stories of the Prophet.
Okay.
So, like, I was going to, so what is the, like, is there, does the same answer apply for this question also?
Okay, sure, inshallah. Okay. Any other calls? Okay. Zainab from United Arab Emirates had also a very important question related to a question which was asked by Sister Anne about the signs of the Day of Judgment. And she said about Al-Mahdi, is Al-Mahdi something true or is it something made up by the Shiites? And that he will be the leader of the Arabs. There are numerous ahadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied the emergence of Al-Mahdi. We don't call him Al-Muntadhar. The word Al-Muntadhar is mainly used by the Shia sect, which means awaited. We're not waiting, sitting, waiting for Al-Mahdi to appear. We're not hanging or suspending our religious duties and worldly activities waiting for Al-Mahdi to appear to rescue the Ummah. What's the story of Al-Mahdi? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the Day of Judgment will not occur, even if there's only a few days left, 3 days in one narration, before Al-Mahdi emerges or comes out. So Al-Mahdi is a human being from the family, from the Prophet's family, the family of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the offspring of Fatima and Ali, may Allah be pleased with them, from the descendant of Al-Husayn radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa adha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about his name, it will coincide and match his own name. So his name will be Muhammad. And his father's name would have the Prophet's father's name, Abdullah. So he'd be named Muhammad ibn Abdullah. And his nickname or kunya will also match the Prophet's kunya, Abu al-Qasim. يُصْلِحُهُ اللَّهُ فِي يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will set right his affairs, will make him a righteous person overnight, and he's able to do all things. He would lead the ummah, he will be praying once with them in the masjid, in Damascus. And this is when Jesus, the son of Mary, will descend, and Mahdi will sense his coming. So he will walk backwarded in order to let Jesus, the son of Mary, lead the prayer. So Isa alayhi salam will tap between his shoulders and say, you stay right there. I am not leading the prayer with any of the imams of the Ummah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rather, he will join Al-Mahdi and follow him. Then afterward, Al-Mahdi and all Muslims will join Isa alayhi salam to chase the false Messiah and Masih al-Dajjal, along with 70,000 Jews from Asbahan, who will be following him. They will chase them until they follow them all the way to Jerusalem. And before, at the gate which is called Lud, Isa alayhi salam will catch the false Messiah and will kill him before he will disappear. Al-Mahdi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us quite a bit about his traits, that يَمْلَأُ الْأَرْضَ قِسْطًا وَعَدْلًا بَعْدَمَا مُلِئَتْ جُورًا وَظُلْمًا. He will spread justice and peace on earth after there was mischief, corruption, and oppression has been widespread on earth. That will be the role of Al-Mahdi. And there is another hadith which is also narrated by Imam Muslim and Al-Bukhari. Jabir ibn Sumurah, may Allah, ibn Samurah, may Allah be pleased with him, and his father, he narrated that once a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the affairs of this ummah will remain steadfast and this ummah will remain mighty as long as there is 12 khulafa or leaders amongst them. The ummah, the mainstream ummah and Ahlul Sunnah are in the general consensus that four of them are Abu Bakr wa Uthman, Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman wa Ali, may Allah be pleased with them. They also said Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is also one of them. And Ibn Kathir, may Allah have mercy on him, in explaining Surah An-Nur said, Al-Mahdi, Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Mahdi, will be also one of the 12 leaders. That is entirely different than what the Shia believe in. The Shia believe that these imams are infallible, and they believe that Al-Mahdi is somebody who was born 500 years ago. He entered into a sardab or a fissure or a cave, and he disappeared after his father was killed. And he's been disappearing and hiding. So they believe that he's alive, and he's been living for the past 500 years or so, and his name is Muhammad al-Askari. That is entirely refused by Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And none of the traits of Al-Mahdi that the Prophet ﷺ applied to him or to the 12 leaders whom the Shia believe in. I hope this is clear. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Sauda from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. How are you, Shaykh?
Great. Alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Shaykh, my question is about the hadith that camel's milk and camel's urine is medicine for certain illness, such as cancer. Is this hadith authentic?
I'm sorry, I did not get the hadith.
Yeah. And please include me in your prayers, Sheikh, because I was diagnosed with breast cancer.
So that inshallah,
I am under my treatment now.
So that inshallah I will pray for you. May Allah give you a quick recovery.
Ameen.
But I didn't
thank
get the hadith.
Okay,
wa alaykum as-salam. We'll try to listen to the hadith in the rerun inshallah, because I don't think she can hear me clearly. Brother Ali from Qatar, assalamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sheikh Salah, how are you, my brother?
Alhamdulillah, my brother, how are you?
This is Abu Haris with you. You remember me? Not from Qatar, from Oman.
From Oman. Yes, Abu Harith, how are you?
Fine, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, not bad, alhamdulillah. May God
may Allah have mercy on your son, am I right?
Yes, you're right, sir.
Okay.
You're very right.
Go ahead, Abu Harith, I hear you.
Alhamdulillah. Brother, last time also I asked you a question. This was regarding her mother most of the time crying for her. Is this... jais in Islam, one thing, and the second question is what about the qaza prayers for our son? How can we compensate that?
Okay, Abu Harith, you're talking about your wife is crying for your son Harith, right?
Yes.
Okay, constantly, and also making of the prayer. Yes, yes. I did answer these two questions back then, but inshallah we'll tackle them quickly. As far as crying, if the person who's mourning the death of any person is feeling sorry but does not object, does not say a word that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is a mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in the heart of his servants. Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her, said upon the death of her father, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya abata, or wa abata, ajaba rabban da'a, wa abata, jannatul firdausi mathwa, wa abata, ila jibreel anan'a. And she was saying facts, she was crying, and she said to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, atabat nufusukum, or anfusakum, atabat anfusukum, an tahthu ala rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at-turab. But she did not say a word showing an objection to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also have to keep in mind that mourning the death of any person, no matter how beloved and dear to you, should not exceed 3 days, except for a wife mourning the death of her husband, 4 months and 10 days. Every once in a while when she remembers him, instead of crying, rather make dua for him, give any charity on his behalf, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. The dua is the thing which will benefit him the most. If you keep crying from now until the day of judgment, it will not revive him back. It will not raise him in ranks. It will not show him how much you love you. But if you instead make dua for him, and in your sujood particularly, that definitely will benefit him. As far as making the qada for a person who missed after his death, no, you cannot make up the prayer on behalf of somebody who died according to the most right view. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Abrar from KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you doing, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah, shukrullah. How are you, brother Abrar?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
I'm glad I didn't say sister Abrar, because his name is broadly used by some sisters as well.
I do understand that every time I call, the same issue is there, but no problem at all.
But you didn't trick me this time, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Sheikh, first of all, thank you very much for such a great show. May Allah bless you with Jannat al-Firdaus.
Ameen, ameen. And you too.
Jazakallah khair. I have three questions. Now, Sheikh, first question is, the age of the mahram when a lady travels, is there a certain limit of age? Could it be a 5-year-old son if he's traveling with his mother?
Okay.
And the second question is the dress code, as in while you're in the house, while a person is outside, everybody knows it. But in the house, like for example, if a father and a mother and there's a 5-year-old son, what is the dress code among the father and mother? For example, is it allowed that I could wear shorts in the house which are a little above the knee, okay. Or is it not allowed at all?
Okay.
And the third question is regarding when you're giving charity. Now, I understand in Islam it says very clearly not to touch any woman.
When you're giving in a charity?
Yeah, make sure that, you know, like shaking hands.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Or something like that. So at some stages what happens is when you're giving charity, you try to close your hand, whatever amount of money you're giving to the person, and there's a lady who's asking for money. Now, if you seal the amount of money and you try to transfer it to her hand,
okay,
your hand has to touch.
Okay, I read you, Abrar. Jazakallah khairan. I got you three questions, and we're due to take a short break, so stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Fairuz from the United States of America had a question pertaining using animals in the lab for research purposes. Is it halal or haram? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, in the sound hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ فَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذَّبْحَ وليحد أحدكم شفرته وليرح ذبيحته. Allah has ordained kindness and gentleness in every case, in every condition, especially even when you have to kill. Then He addressed the killing of animals, slaughtering the animals, which He allowed us to eat. He said, وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَةُ. When you come to slaughter your animal, you have to be merciful as well. But I don't understand, how can you be merciful in slaughtering? He said, فَلْيُحِدَّ أَحَدُكُمْ شَفْرَتَهُ وَلْيُرِحْ ذَبِيحَتَهُ. Place your animal in a comfortable position and sharpen your knife in order to be swift. And he said to one who was slaughtering his sheep before another, he said, you've killed it twice, because animals also do understand the pain and the suffering. So if Allah ordained for us and allowed us to consume their flesh and slaughter them and ordain on them to be patient, we have to be merciful as well. Same thing, it is permissible to utilize animals in the research for the sake of serving humanity, but we have to be merciful. I remember in the labs, where sometimes when we're doing autopsy on frogs or rabbits or whatever, after we finish, many of our colleagues would not care about what happened to the animal afterward. Sometimes you will leave it in pens and open heart or open stomach, and just neglect it until it dies. No, that's not merciful. If we have to use them as an alternative to humans, it is permissible with conditions. We have to make certain that if it is not accessible to treat the animal afterward in order to recover, then at least its life should be taken. Not to leave it to be tortured and experience a very severe pain while we go home and we relax. That if there is no alternative, if we can find a new technology, or if it is available, like in some universities, there is a new technology that we can follow without utilizing the animals in the research, but it's hard to find, then it is permissible with conditions. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Afia from KSA. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. Thank you, sister.
Sheikh, I have one question regarding this hadith from one of the authentic Sikh books, which is mentioned. Hadith is narrated by Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, radiallahu anhu, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you go to relieve yourself, do not face or put your back to the Qibla. Instead, face east or the west. The problem was that one of a relative went in Medina, in the five-star hotel, the toilets were all facing to the Qibla.
Okay.
And so we were very much confused. And they were confused either to follow this or to just agree what it was there.
Okay, Sister Afia, I got your question. It is not like what most people think once they read the hadith, that when you build your restroom, it must not be facing the Qibla. If it is an indoor restroom, it doesn't matter because it's indoor. The problem is if one is relieving himself in the open and facing the Qibla, that is restricted. Okay? Facing or giving.
Not in the open.
Not in the open. But in closed doors or at home, indoor I mean, there is no problem. The restriction does not apply here, okay?
Yeah, but the Sheikh, they have mentioned there ahead, Abu Ayyub stated when he came to Asham, we found the bathrooms within the building facing the Qibla. So we would turn ourselves away and ask Allah's forgiveness. What does this mean then?
If the person have an access to do that from the beginning, fine. But if you enter any place and the bathroom is facing the Qibla indoor, the restriction does not apply here. Okay? Thank you. Barakallah fiqh. It really pleases me to see that, alhamdulillah, Muslims have this great awareness of the deen and very keen, even while answering the call of nature, while relieving oneself, realizing that there is a certain etiquette has to be followed and prophetic adab. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Yasmin from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello, Sheikh. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum. Assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Hello.
I hear you, Yasmin.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum. Assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, I have a question. My husband is in Italy. And now I am planning to travel to my country in the Philippines with my daughter. Is it permissible or not? And I'm living now with my in-law, with my brother-in-law. Is it permissible, even though one of my in-laws molested my daughter?
Okay. Umm Yasmin, I got your question. Thank you. The answer to traveling for a woman without a male mahram has been already answered in the beginning of the show. But there is a very important part of the question which is pertaining the brother-in-law. My brother-in-law is traveling with me. Is the brother-in-law a male mahram? No, he is not. The brother-in-law is not a male mahram. So one should not consider him a legitimate male mahram to travel with. Traveling without a male mahram for a woman will be allowed in case of necessity if she does not have one and she has to travel. Okay? Sister, we had a very important question in the beginning of the program pertaining the unity of the Ummah and how can we unify the Ummah. I just don't remember the name of the sister who asked the question. The Prophet ﷺ has said that there is nothing will set out the affairs of this Ummah straight other than what it has set it out straight in its beginning. When the Prophet ﷺ was ready to depart this life, he said, I'm leaving for you two things, which if you hold fast to them, you'll never go astray. And you'll be always superior. The book of Allah and the traditions of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And when he prophesies that the Ummah will be divided into various sects, like what happened to the Jews and Christians, he said there's only one party which will be saved. And when he said 72 out of the 73 are astray, it doesn't mean that the vast majority of the Ummah are going astray. Because some of these sects, their followers are maybe hundreds of thousands, maybe just hundreds. But the mainstream Ummah, alhamdulillah, is the vast majority. That's called Al-Jama'ah. In order to unite the Ummah, of course we're not talking about uniting them on certain fiqh issues, like where to put your hands on the chest, beneath the navel, all of that is valid, all of that is fine, doesn't affect the validity of the prayer. We're talking about the unity over the aqidah. That is the strongest bond and tie that unites the members of this ummah. And that's why the right order that the Prophet ﷺ followed in order to unite the ummah was kalimatu tawheed. First, then tawheed al-kalima. Establishing, affirming the word of unity. the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the unity of His Lordship, the unity of worship, the unity of His beautiful names and attributes, that no one shares with Him any of that. 13 years in Mecca, he spent just to establish this foundation, لا إله إلا الله. Then after people absorbed that and recognized what it means, and they were ready to practice it, once he immigrated to Al-Madina, it was a piece of cake to gather Al-Ansar and Al-Muhajireen and establish the unity of the brotherhood, which was similar to the blood brotherhood and kinship. To establish unity between Al-Aus wal-Khazraj, between the Arab and the non-Arab, and so on. It was very simple, because we have one thing in common, the strongest and the most powerful, which is the Aqidah. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. But if somebody thinks that one day we can be united with those who have doubts in the righteousness of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, accuse them with false accusations, they are gravely mistaken. That will never happen. If somebody may contemplate that one day Baha'is, Ahmadis, Ismailis, Qadianis, or whatever can be united to the ministry of Ummah, no way, because these are not Muslims. If we're talking about Muslims, whoever faces the same Qibla, whoever considers the halal and haram pertaining to the dhabiha and the process of slaughtering, and the only slaughter in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not in the name of any wali or zakay or whatever, whoever follows the same traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once it is confirmed that it is sound and authentic, this is a mainstream ummah. And you find this bond of unity between us, despite the fact that somebody is in India and another is in the States and a third is in Russia and one in Saudi or in Cairo, we have the same belief, we have the same traditions, we love one another even without meeting. If we hear that brother or sheikh so and so is sick in one of the states in America, and despite the fact that maybe we have never met him, but we pray for him, we love him at first, because we know about his aqidah and his belief. That is a cement which will tie us together. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Behold, you all fast to the robe of Allah, that is Al-Qur'an. If somebody has a problem with the Qur'an, not a chance that he can be united or related to the Muslims. And the Qur'an ordered us to stick to the teachings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, respect and love his companions. May Allah be pleased with him. Last phone call, assalamu alaikum. Abdul Aziz from Algeria, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Good evening.
Thank you and good evening.
I have a question. I am working, I am teaching in secondary school, but the problem is mixed, you know, boys and girls.
Yeah.
Secondary school, okay. So, what's the decision of Islam or Hukum, whether to complete or not? I am annoyed somehow about the situation.
Okay. I guess we also have a pending question pertaining the same matter. I will explain that inshallah. If I have a chance after answering Abrar's questions, the age of the male mahram. The normal is the age of puberty. Once a child reaches the age of puberty and he's saying that he's a mahram, if he's a male. But if he is mumayyiz, understands what's going on, understands responsibility, even before that age, the age of puberty, then he can be considered a mahram. There are some kids at the age of 9 and 10 whom you can rely on, because the purpose of al-mahramiyya is to have a man with you or a responsible person who may protect you. What to wear before the kids? The awra, before anybody other than your wife, even before your children, before your parents, before your brothers and sisters, is from the navel to the knees. For a child who's 4 or 5 years old, still not mumayyiz, I believe it would be okay. But if the child is mumayyiz and understands, that the parents have to be very careful with what they wear before the children, not to send the wrong signal. touching a woman's hand while giving her the charity, if it was not deliberate, then there is no blame on you. And I know that you're trying to conceal your sadaqah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept, but you know, this is not what's meant with touching the woman's hand. If you put it in her hand and you touch her accidentally without intention, no big deal. Brothers and sisters, unfortunately, once again, we came to the end of the program. By the end, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept and to pardon us for any errors, mistakes, and correct our mistakes. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Until next time, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I